My earliest interest in science really stemmed from my love of nature and the outdoors and wanting to understand why the world worked the way it worked and why animals did the things that they did. My parents recognized pretty early on that I was a very curious kid and did their best to encourage that. And I was lucky enough to have teachers who also instilled and fostered that curiosity in me. My name is Erin Waggoner, and I'm an aerospace engineer in the Aerodynamics and Propulsion Branch, and I work for NASA. So I got into engineering, and then I ultimately went and majored in aerospace engineering at Wichita State University and minored in math. Because I knew I ultimately wanted to end up at NASA someday for my career, I applied to be a co-op through the school's co-op office.
The boom was very faint across the entire carpet.
So I ended up getting picked up by NASA Armstrong, and I came out here sight unseen. I absolutely loved the work I was doing. I started out on Sophia, and then I had the luck to go over to CEV and then X-48. So I got to see a lot of the very unique projects that were coming through here in the early 2010s era. And I got a call just before I was graduating from college with a formal job offer from here, and it was my dream come true. Essentially, my job entails everything from planning a flight test all the way through executing a flight test and looking at the data afterwards. My current project is the Acoustic Research Measurement, or ARM-3 flights. ARM-3 uses a large microphone array that's set up in a spiral pattern called a beam-forming microphone array to measure aircraft noise off of the G3. And essentially what we're doing is trying to measure aircraft noise and look at aircraft noise mitigation measures. So we have various fairings and flaps and cavity treatments that we've put on the airplane, and we're trying to see what the effect of those treatments is on the overall noise signature of the airplane.
3, 2, 1.
The beam-forming array is also called an acoustic camera. It gives you a picture of an airplane that looks a lot like a heat map, if you've ever seen a heat map. But in the picture of the airplane that we end up getting, red is noisy or loud instead of hot. So we can use this to tell where the noisiest parts of the airplane are, and we can use this to figure out if any of our mitigations have been successful and to what extent they have been successful.
Mike, bad copy. Let's go ahead and move to 165. Gear up.
20.
During an ARM flight, the G3 flies essentially an approach over the microphone array.
3, 2, 1, descend, 2.3.
Well, before they reach the array, the pilots have throttled back the engines so that it's as quiet as possible from an engine perspective while they're over the array. We also have them fly at various different air speeds and with various different flap deflections because that will affect the noise signature. So on the other side of the sound barrier, I do more acoustic research on the supersonic side of things. It's not a boom that happens once, or it's not a boom that happens once or twice, in that a lot of people think, okay, so I've sped up, I've broken through this sound barrier, it's gone, I am no longer producing a sonic boom, and then when I slow down and I break through it the other way, now I'm gonna make a boom. It's really not like that. It's more like a wake on a boat. So as long as it's moving supersonically or over the speed of sound, you're going to continue to drag effectively a wake of a sonic boom with you through the air that will reach the ground. I've worked on sonic bat recently, and that was a test to look at how sonic booms propagate through a turbulent atmosphere. During that project, I had the privilege to fly in the TG-14 and record the sonic booms between where they were produced on the aircraft and where they were recorded on the ground. The rationale behind using the TG-14 is because it's a motorized glider, so the engine can be turned off and on in the middle of a flight, and it's a very quiet aircraft. So the F-18 would produce the boom from a very specific location and at a very specific airspeed. The TG-14 would record the boom as it had propagated through the atmosphere prior to it hitting the turbulent layer. And then the microphone arrays on the ground would record how that sonic boom sounded on the ground after it had gone through the layer of turbulence. The way I describe engineering now is that you have this giant puzzle and you have to follow some rules in order to solve your problem. But the only rules that you have to follow are physics and math. And if you follow physics and math, and you can find the right technology, you can solve any problem you want to solve.
Filling up.
I mean, ultimately, I just feel very blessed to be able to work here. And that's what I wanted. You can't let anybody define your path for you. You have to have the confidence in yourself to go after your goals and to go after your dreams. And you can't let those people deter you.